felt the pain from a shotgun? Have you ever cried the tears of the lonely? Hard Rockology Show. I'm Chris. Bang Tango, Attack of Life, going back to their 1989 album Psycho Cafe. And they got a new movie out called Attack of Life, the Bang Tango movie. And the guy responsible for it, we're going to be talking to right now, Drew Fortier. Drew, thanks for taking time out to talk to Hard Rockology.
Oh, thank you so much for having me on the show, man. I'm stoked.
Yeah, I'm glad finally somebody made a movie about a band that, I hate to say it, that really didn't have the superstardom like you see all the bands on the VH1 show Behind the Music, you know, where most people know that, yeah, they struggled and then they made it big and then now they have money and now they're just doing whatever. But with Bang Tango, not the case.
Right, exactly. It's always the bands that didn't make it that have the most interesting stories, I think.
Yeah, and you had like Dee Snider in the very beginning of the movie read that little blurb. I mean, tell me a little bit about that. I mean, whose idea was that?
Oh, man, I wrote out the introduction, and as I was writing it, I was like, man, Dee Snider would be like perfect to do something like this. And so I just sent his manager an email. I was like, just, you never know unless you try or ask. And his manager called me. He was like, yeah, Dee wants to do it. I was like, how much? He was like, oh, don't worry about it. I'm like, all right, cool. And so he did it, and then he did a couple cold takes. I never met him, never talked to him or nothing. He did a couple cold takes, and then they sent me the file, and he put in his own two cents during one of the takes, and that's in the movie where he goes up on like a little rant, and I thought that was hysterical and perfect and set the tone like perfectly. So went with it, and it was just you know, so happy he was able to do that for me.
Yeah, because it was kind of funny. It's almost like it begins like. You get the narration and he's reading and all of a sudden he kind of stops and it seems like he loses his train of thought and he goes, what am I talking about here? What? This is really going on? This is really what this movie's about? Okay. You know, I'm rooting for him. I think that's what he says. He goes, I'm rooting for him or whatever. And this is the story about the other 3% or right, 97% exactly. Or whatever.
Oh yeah. And it worked perfectly because I'm sure a lot of people are like, Bang Tango movie, what? And then they start watching that and they kind of, you know, identify with Dee doing that. They're like, yeah, Dee's right. What? Okay. Rooting for him. Let's see how this goes.
So I first heard about the movie when I interviewed the current bass player in the band, Lance Eric, back in 2012. And he said there was a movie being made about Bang Tango. And then I saw periodically little trailers on YouTube, and I said, wow, this looks like a really cool movie, the way, especially the music that you had in the background in the trailer, because it wasn't always their big hits. It was, I believe one of the songs was Crazy, and it really kind of worked, and I got sucked in right away going, God, when is this movie coming out? So tell me a little bit about why you decided to make it, and then we'll go through how you made it.
Sure. Okay. It all happened on accident, to tell you the truth. And I was bartending at this club on the south side of Chicago, and my boss was like, hey, man, you know, Bang Tango was going to play here soon. And I was like, oh, I remember the name. My older brother was huge in all that music. So when I was growing up, I kind of followed his taste. So I remember hearing Bang Tango. And then they showed up, and I happened to have, like, a camera in my hand. And Joe came up to me, and the first thing he asked was, hey, man, you know where I can find some weed? You look cool. And I was like, no, sorry, dude. And then he's like, what's that in your hand? I was like, oh, it's a camera. He was like, what's that? No, he didn't say that, but might as well have. But and then he's like, dude, we're recording in Chicago in 2 weeks. Why don't you come on down into the studio and record like a studio documentary for YouTube or something? I'm like, all right. And I had no background in film, video, absolutely nothing. I just happened to be some dude standing there with a camera who worked at the club. And actually that night, you know, Joe found out I play guitar and he had me come up and do a a Led Zeppelin song with the band, and it was a mess because he forgot to tell the band that we were doing that. Uh-huh. And so we started playing that Bring It On Home by Zeppelin. And then the intro is this instrumental, just guitar and vocals. And then when the drums are supposed to kick in, everybody's just looking at each other like, well, we were supposed to do something. Oh, Joe didn't tell us. And it was hysterical. It was great. It was like deer in headlights. And then from that, I showed up at the airport when I flew in to go to the studio. And I think they were surprised I actually showed up. They're like, you're that guy. I'm like, yeah, I told you I'd show up. And then I just was at the studio with him every day and just got a ridiculous amount of footage. And me and my friend Joe Pluskowski, who's a producer in the movie, known him since high school, he was there too. And it just went great. And Joe went into like the history of the band and all that, and how, you know, he's the only guy left and carrying the flag and everything. I was like, oh, that's interesting. And then I played on that album too, Pistol Whipped in the Bible Belt.
Yeah, I was gonna ask you if that was the album that they were in there recording. That was the one that came out, I believe, what, in 2012 or 11 or something?
Yeah, at the end of 2011, they had to send Scotty home, the guitar player at the time, and they had me do the lead parts during the chorus of Live Life. And I was like, all right, that was pretty cool. And then from that, you know, Joe just gave me the rundown of the band and everything. I got a hold of Mark Knight, the original guitar player, and that's when the floodgates opened up. I was like, holy crap, you know. And then I started interviewing everybody in the original band. Mark Knight set all that up and everything, and all became good buddies. And then I ended up getting Ricky Rackman, Howard Benson, the first producer, and
Chip's enough in there.
Yeah, Chip. Yeah, Chip's a buddy. He turned into a really, really good buddy of mine. I love him so much. He's such a great dude. And then all the in-between members of Bang Tango, too, like Danny Aon, Mark Tremaglia, and all the guys that nobody would know unless you look at the Wikipedia page.
Yeah, there's a huge list there, like 13. I think they have, like, I think I saw it on Sleaze Rock at one time. They had, like, bands with the most different members, and I think Bang Tango was up there, like, over 20-something or something. I couldn't even believe it.
Oh, man, it was insane. Yeah, there was a... When he reformed the band in the early 2000s, that's when it was just like revolving door like crazy. So I tell people I'm the 37th guitar player of Bang Tango, and people actually do believe me that I'm the 37th guitar player of Bang Tango.
So really, this all just was, you're just at a bar, you're working, and you got a video camera, right? And he just comes up to you, and this, it's really, really, that's the whole story, right?
Oh, there's a lot more to it.
Well, yeah, I'm sure there is, but I mean, that's like pretty much...
That's how it started, yeah.
But I mean, go ahead. I mean, continue. I mean, about how, I mean, you got Mark Knight. I was going to say, okay, so now.
I never planned on editing the movie. I was just like, I'm just going to shoot a bunch of footage, and I'm sure the band knows somebody that can hand it to edit the whole thing. And it turns out that was false. And then Trent, the drummer at the time, great guy, he asked me to, because I had all the studio footage, if I could cut together like a music video for that song Live Life from Pistol Whipped. And I never edited anything before in my life. And then I was like, all right, I give it a try, you know, and no clue what I'm doing. So I slapped it together like the best I could, and like where it would like make sense. And then everybody really, really liked it. Their booking agent loved it. And I guess their booking agent liked it so much because it actually made Bang Tango look good and actually, you know, appealing, because they were getting a bad reputation the past couple of years up until that point for being a revolving door band and, like, you know, Joe being drunk all the time and everything. And so he really liked that, and he got me a lot of work doing promo videos for all of his roster and all that too. So I've been doing that ever since. And then I ended up doing like 4 or 5 music videos for Bang Tango, and then there was that. And then 2011, and then kept getting more and more interviews from everybody. And the next thing I knew, I ended up with like 400 hours of footage.
Uh-huh.
It was ridiculous. And I was like, what am I going to do, you know? So I just kept on putting out like a trailer like every couple months just to let people know, hey, there's still something going on here. But, you know, truthfully, I had no clue what I was doing. And then, so that went on for like a couple of years. Finally, I got to the point where I was like, okay, it's been like three and a half years. I should probably attempt this. So then I put my sanity aside for like 6 months, and I sat down and went through everything, which, you know, with all this, I learned how to make a movie and how not to make a movie. It was just soul crushing. And so I started making the story happen, and it came together, you know, pretty quick in that sense. And it's just that classic story, you know, the band that could have been something more. And I just finally got a rough cut done and showed it to everybody. Everybody loved it and hated it at the same time because it was too honest. It was too brutal, too X-rated with all the stories and all that. So then from that, I had to whittle it down a little bit, and that's the final cut that everybody got to see. But yeah.
Did you leave a lot of X-rated stuff out? Because, I mean, I didn't get that impression like anything was left out. I mean, I had a couple of things I was going to ask you, but first, I mean, it was like, you know, it I like the way you told the story. It was like from the beginning all the way to the end. It starts like at the top, and then it just shows you all the way through. It was pretty easy, and you had the dates on there, and everything was kind of nice that it had that kind of a flow to it. And there was no narrator either. That's what I thought was really interesting. It was just all of a sudden you see a person, and then they're talking about Bang Tango, then it goes to somebody else, and it didn't spend too much time on any individual, but kind of kept the movie moving along, which is what I liked about it. And it kept me interested for the whole, what is it, hour and 20 minutes or so, but it went by really quick.
Oh, thank you so much, man. Yeah, I figured like the whole mentality was how can I make it work for somebody who never heard of the band before? So to start at the beginning.
Exactly, exactly.
To where it is now.
Yeah, and I thought that even if you're not a fan of Bang Tango, you'll probably go out and buy at least a couple of their albums after you see the movie, because it's like one of those movies where if you like rock and roll, heavy metal, whatever, this is a cool story about a band that, you know what, they didn't make it. They almost made it. They got a record deal. They had stuff happen to them. Guys had problems. Some of them didn't want to do it anymore. Like I believe Kyle Stevens was just done with it. He even said that in the movie, you know,
right,
which he was just done with the whole thing. And it's just interesting to get an idea about, you know, what happens to the band if they don't make it. And then one guy who wants to keep it going on.
Right, right, exactly. And that's and Joe, you know, everybody, even the original guys, give him credit for just keeping it going for so long and just still being passionate about it. And you know, he is, you know, Bang Tango. He's just, you know, and love it. Love Joe very much.
Well, who was the hardest one to interview? Because it seemed to me like okay, you have Joe Lestay, who's the lead singer of Bang Tango, in case people don't know that. And but it's like if it was like his baby, this is what he continues to keep doing. I mean, I know he had the Beautiful Creatures band in the early 2000s, which was a good band too. Then he went back to Bang Tango. But I mean, in the movie, the only thing that came across to me was like you kind of want him to talk a little bit more about some of the stuff that happened. And he was just kind of like, yeah, whatever, man. You know, yeah, I mean, did you get that impression sometimes when you were interviewing him?
Oh yeah. Joe, he was the hardest one to interview. We ended up doing like 4 or 5 interviews, with him. And, he's kind of camera shy, you know, it's like Joe in real life is a bit different from Joe in the movie, but that's how he is on camera. He's just really, you know, kind of a little bit shy, a little self-conscious, you know. There's nothing wrong with that. But that the final interview, like we did, I actually had Lance do it, the bass player, because he was a bit more comfortable. Like, you know, it was at Joe's home. And I had like a phone book full of questions because it was like, okay, we got to redo Joe's interview again. So let's just get everything out the way. And the Beautiful Creatures question was toward the end. And by that point, Joe was just like, oh, let's just stick to Bang Tango so we could, you know, move on, get done with the interview, you know. So a lot of people were saying that they wish he talked about Beautiful Creatures a lot more. And that's really the reason why. He just wanted to keep on talking about Bang Tango because that interview, the uncut interview, is probably like 2 hours long at least.
Yeah.
And he was just so just burnt out by that point. But who knows, maybe a Beautiful Creatures documentary could happen too, because that's like the almost like the same kind of story, but in a different era.
Yeah, exactly. And I mean, that was like a couple of great albums too. And I always thought that the songs were really good on that record too.
Oh, absolutely. Definitely. Love the first one so much. I remember seeing them at Ozfest in 2001. I was like, I think 13 or 14. And I just loved it and thought they were great. And I thought the one thing that went against them, they did that Ozfest tour, but their album didn't come out till after Ozfest. So that kind of hurt them, I think, because I think they could have sold a lot of records if it had to come out while they were on Ozfest.
I remember when I first I went to a Best Buy back in 2000. I saw that record because I start in the A section, working my way all the way down to Z, and I saw it in the B section, and I'm like, oh, what band is this? I never heard of this band. And I pick it up, and I turn around the back, and I look, and I go, that looks like the guy from Bang Tango. It looks like Joe Lestay. I think I'll pick up this album, and that album didn't leave my player for almost a whole year. That's how good it was.
Oh, it's so great. Amazing record.
Yeah, and had DJ Oshba on it, too, and I mean, the guitar playing on that album is phenomenal.
Oh yeah, Glenn Sobel on drums. I think he's playing with Alice Cooper now, and yeah, a lot of those guys. All those guys went on to do great things, and Joe just, you know, kind of chugged along and just kept Bang Tango going. He's true to himself, I guess, in a sense, because everybody else in that band went on to go do like amazing things, and he just stuck with his roots.
Yeah, yeah. All right, so what I want to do, Drew, is let's take a quick break. We'll play a Bang Tango song, one of the ones you picked. This is going back to, I think, their first album. Let's play Sweet Little Razor. We'll be back more with Drew about the attack of life, the Bang Tango movie, right after this. Check it out. We'll be right back. we're back, Chris, and we're talking with Drew Fortier, the director, editor, pretty much everything of the new Bang Tango movie, Attack of Life. We were talking about Joe Lestay a minute ago, and another guy I wanted to talk about that you interviewed was producer Howard Benson, who produced the first Bang Tango album, and then he also produced the third album, Love After Death. I mean, what was it like talking to him?
Actually, the other producer of the movie, Anu Gunn, he was like the savior for the project, because there was no budget for the movie, and he lived in L.A., and he's an amazing videographer, so he did an interview for the movie himself, and because he's a Bang Tango fan, and he offered to shoot interviews in L.A. when I couldn't afford to fly out there, so he did that one. He did a lot of them, and the uncut Howard Benson interview was amazing. He covers everything from, you know, not just Bang Tango, but the music business then and now, and all that, and it's just a stellar interview. Like, I'd love to just release it as is, because it's so good. And while making the movie, I was in L.A. doing video work from Mark Knight's band, and Howard invited me over to his house, and we got to hang with him for a little bit. And he's a wonderful guy, great dude, brutally honest, and great sense of humor. But looks fondly back on Bang Tango big time, because that was his first big band he got to work with, and the first time his music was played on MTV and all that. And so he's he's a wonderful guy, great dude. And I'd love to show everybody that interview he did too, because it's just, you know, it's so good.
It sounds like another project, because I mean, that guy's a big time producer. I mean, look, all you got to do is go to Wikipedia and look at all the bands he's produced. I'm not going to go into all of them right now, but I mean, that would be an interesting story too, I think. So hey, I might have just given you another project, you know?
Yeah, you're right. That would be a good one, because, you know, from Bang Tango to like Kelly Clarkson, because everybody.
Exactly. I think Three Doors Down is in there too.
Motorhead.
A lot of Motorhead albums, actually.
Yeah, he did a couple of them.
So out of the people that you interviewed, I got a lot out of guitarist of Bang Tango, Mark Knight. I thought his interviews in the movie were really, really interesting and entertaining, and he pretty much tells it like it is and doesn't hold any punches, but he doesn't seem to have any grudges towards anybody either. He's like going, hey, you know what? I mean, if you want to get back together, we can do this, do that, whatever. I mean, he didn't really have a bad thing to say. It was just kind of interesting to listen to him tell the story about what happened.
Oh, yeah, Mark's a great guy. Like, and he did that interview too, just, you know, uncut, is just wonderful as well. And yeah, he looks back fondly on Bang Tango big time. That was his baby. He was like the big initiator of all those songs. Like, he, you know, a lot of those were his ideas, like starting off. And he's like the storyteller of the whole movie, because he's in throughout the whole thing, and he's just kind of like the grounded, like, you know, level-headed guy that kind of walks everybody through the movie. And it's pretty cool. He's a wonderful guy too, really, really close friend. And he actually he played with us at the Whiskey. He did a couple songs with us for the first time. Him and Joe didn't see each other for like 10 years, and it was like worth doing the movie just to witness them two, like, you know, saying hello to each other again after all that time.
Yeah, that's why I went on YouTube to think of that was going to be like the Whiskey show from a couple of weeks back. What song did he play? I'm guessing it's Dancing on Coals and Someone Like You. I'm just guessing.
Oh, I wish there was footage of it, because there's a little bit of him doing the intro of Someone Like You, but he came up and did Wrap My Wings, Don't Stop Now, and Someone Like You.
Oh,
and
that's cool.
Yeah, it was so cool. I wish there was video of it. Of the whole thing, and unfortunately, there's nothing on YouTube yet. But it was so cool. People were like blown away, and it was a great moment.
So you can see the chemistry between them still, right?
Absolutely. Oh, yeah. There's some good pictures floating around on Facebook of them too, and it's just like not a day has passed, you know, because the last time they saw each other was at a Bang Tango reunion show back in 06 or 07, I believe.
Yeah, I did see footage of that on TV too. That was pretty cool.
Oh yeah, yeah, and. And that show was on YouTube mislabeled as being from 2015, but it was from like 2006, 2007 or something like that.
Yes. Yeah, the anniversary, when they got the 20-year anniversary or something, I think it was.
Right, right. And they hadn't seen each other since, and they'd talk here and there and all that. And then, you know, when you know, Mark came backstage with the Whiskey, then Joe came up, and then two just saw each other and just like hugs and kisses, man. It was beautiful. It was a wonderful moment.
Yeah, that's the cool thing about rock and roll. I mean, it's like you always hear about people not getting along and stuff, which happens more often than not. But for some reason, when they get on stage, there's no one that can replace the other person as far as making the music the best it can be. You know what I'm saying? It's just very difficult to do that.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. Those two, it's like the chemistry never left the room. They got Mark got up on stage, and them two just, you know, it was great. And Mark and Rowan had a great dynamic on stage too, like trading off solos and all that. It was awesome.
So did you get to interview all the guys in the band, or excuse me, like you said, I know you didn't interview Howard Benson, but I mean, did you interview like Kyle Stevens and Kyle and then Tig?
I interviewed Tig and Kyle Stevens. Kyle shot his own interview. That's actually the his backyard at his house.
Yeah, I was going to say that's a nice spread. He was like seemed pretty relaxed there with the pool in the background. It's pretty cool.
Oh yeah, the pool changes colors and everything.
Exactly. I was like, why is the pool just change color? Yeah, it just did.
That was not CGI.
Yeah, you know? And you probably seen that pool a million times doing the editing, right?
Oh my god, yeah, I memorized how many times it changes colors and like the sequence of it. It was just that movie. Just never ever watch that movie again. It's just, oh man, it makes no sense to me at all.
So you interviewed, like you said, Tig and Kyle Stevens, right?
Right. Tig, Kyle Stevens. I knew, interviewed Ricky Rackman. Ricky's a great guy. He's a wonderful dude as well. And I interviewed TJ, Thomas James, the guy that filled in for Joe when he got sick.
That's an interesting story. Tell me about that story real quick. I mean, because since you interviewed him, I mean, for people who don't know, I mean, I don't know if I want to ruin it if you haven't seen the movie yet, but I'm going to ruin it anyway. This guy goes to see Bang Tango, a diehard fan. Joe Lestay gets sick or something happens. He has to go to the hospital. They need a singer. This guy goes up on stage. It's kind of like that rock star movie.
Yeah, exactly. It's exactly how it was. And TJ's such a great guy. And everybody involved with Bang Tango are all just really great dudes. It's, you know, it's just awesome. And he became a good friend too. And yeah, he was. I contacted him about doing an interview for the movie, and he was surprised. He's like, "You want me to?" You know, he's such a humble dude. And every time Bang Tango plays Chicago, we have him come up, and he sings "Someone Like You" and all that. It's pretty cool. And and he was at the screening at the movie in Chicago. That was really cool. And it was funny because Alex Grassi said that he gave him $100 after the show. And as that was happening at the premiere, TJ was like, "I didn't get paid $100."
That's what he said in the movie. Yeah, he did say that in the movie. And then you also interviewed the drummer Tig Kettler, right?
Oh yeah, Tig's awesome. Tig's crazy. He's best sense of humor ever. He's such a fun guy. And I ended up interviewing him twice, and that was actually his interview took place in the beer garden of the Malibu Inn.
I was going to say, there's a beer in the scene, and he's drinking the beer, and I'm like, oh, I wonder what kind of beer that is. And then my brother and I were watching a movie, and he's like, oh, wow, he's really nursing that beer through this whole interview. Maybe it's another beer or not. I don't know.
Right, yeah, exactly. I think that was a Red Stag or something. I forget what it was.
Yeah.
That was after a Mark Knight show, Mark Knight and the Unsung Heroes. Me and Tig went out into the beer garden to set everything up, and he was like, all right, let's go.
That's cool. And then the other guy, Kyle Stevens, the other guitar player for the band.
Oh yeah, he's awesome. He's great, dude. He's got his own furniture company called Lotus Woodworking in California, and he's been very successful with that. He still plays music. He still plays guitar and all that. And you know, he's another great dude, another great guy.
So when you're filming the movie, did you get a sense that these guys were like ever really pissed off that it didn't work out? Because I mean, after the first album, Psycho Cafe, that was a great album. And everybody says, well, the second album wasn't as good. And I'm like, oh, well, the second album was just different. And maybe because he had a different producer, you know, but still, I thought it was still just as good of a Bang Tango album as the first one. And then the third one was a great album, too. So you kind of had three great albums by a band, which nowadays, I mean, how many times you listen to, like, maybe three or four songs off a 10-song record, and then the rest of them aren't even that good. But with Bang Tango, it never was the case.
Right, yeah, it's no fillers. It's all just great songs, and they were all they're all at peace with everything with Bang Tango too. It's like, you know, that was a part of my life that happened a long time ago, and you know, everybody's just at peace with it now. And so that was really cool. They were really open to talking about everything and anything, and it was it was wonderful, great experience interviewing those guys.
There's the one part of the movie where you talk about what the band was doing in the late 90s with Kyle and Joe Lestay. They put a band together called Eating Crow.
Oh, now, yeah.
I followed music forever, and my brother and I looked at each other going, how do we get recordings of these songs? Because they sounded fantastic, at least what we saw in the movie. They were pretty cool songs.
Oh yeah, Eating Crow. I got a couple of the demos I'll share with you, and absolutely amazing, like that. Oh man, and that one song that was in the movie, "So Abused," that was in the Wishmaster movie.
Yes,
like in '97. And that's what's crazy is I remember when I was a little kid, I saw that. I saw that at the movies, and I heard that song, and I was like, "Who is this?" You know, and I never heard it again. And then all these years later, I'm doing the Bang Tango documentary, and Kyle is showing me some of the Eating Crow stuff. I was like, no way, it's that song I've been trying to figure out for like 15 years. So it was like a weird, like, you know, just a weird thing. But yeah, there's like four or five demos, I think, and they're all just amazing. They're all just great songs. It's like a really gothy, like U2. It's really cool.
Yeah, and I love the sound of it. I mean, it was that like a live performance or a video that you used for the movie?
Oh, that was actually a demo recording. That's the only version of it out there. And I think it's on that song's on YouTube, I believe. But it has the intro was a cut off, all weird. So I had to do some like audio editing and make it sound like it was the full intro. And yeah, that's all that's out there for that one. Just that Eating Crow song, "So Abused." And I've been trying to get Joe to play that one live with Bang Tango, because in the late '90s, Bang Tango played that song at their shows. And then that the footage while that's playing is from a show in '97 at in L.A. I forgot.
It looks like it's the Roxy.
Yeah, I think it's the Roxy. And and then I got that whole show on DVD, and it's great. That late '90s Bang Tango was just you know, never talked about, never really published. You know, it's such a great era in that band too. It was so interesting because they really went in a different direction with all those that Eating Crow and all that and everything. It was just awesome.
And then also in the movie, you had a lot of live concert footage. Is there like full movies of the whole performance, or did you just have to find out? I mean, how did you go about finding out all the live performance?
That was actually from Kyle Stevens. He actually had a bunch of Bang Tango bootlegs from way back when. He has a whole pro shot show from Tokyo, Japan from like '92. Okay. Right before Love After Death came out, and has a bunch of Love After Death songs on there. It's, you know, great quality. If you clean up the video a little bit, you can totally put it out there as like a DVD. It's all pro shot, pro audio. He had a bunch of VHS tapes of like his last show with Bang Tango. I got that one, and a lot of shows around like the Love After Death era. Like when in the movie, a lot of times I have Joe like talking between songs when he's talking about, like, we got a new album coming out, Love After Death, you know, and all that. That's from those shows that Kyle sent me. And it's the whole I got all these bootlegs from Bang Tango. So if you want to check them out, I'll send them to you. They're great.
Yeah, because I was like, that's what I was like. It's so hard to find live performances of them on YouTube. And then when I saw it in the movie, I'm like going, wow, this looks like a really cool show. And then the way you kind of edited the performance with a different song or whatever, it works. It really works. And I thought you did a really good job on that.
Oh, thank you so much, man. Thank you.
This is coming from somebody who's never edited a movie before, right?
Oh, I don't recommend anybody try that.
All right, so we're going to take another quick break. Why don't you introduce the other song that you wanted to play right now? I'll have you it, Drew.
Oh, yeah, this is my favorite song by Bang Tango. I love playing it live with them. This is My Favorite Nine.
Playing with my mind. Oh yeah. When someone comes banging
Hard Rockology Show. We're talking with Drew Fortier, the director of Attack of Life, the Bang Tango movie. And Drew, is this movie, is it going to be coming out, or is it just going to be on YouTube right now? What's the story behind that?
Well, for now, it's just going to be on YouTube. I've actually had a couple of distribution offers for it, but they were like, okay, we'll give you this advance and we'll put it out, but you have to clear the songs. And I was like, ah, crap. And so I spent a long time, probably a year, year and a half, probably even longer than that, because I'm still editing the movie and still trying to look into that. So probably about, say, like, safely, like, 2 years, just going back and forth with, like, Universal, because MCA was bought out by Universal, I believe, a couple years ago. And so Universal has all the masters and all that. And they just kind of put me in contact with one person, then that person, like, led me to somebody else and somebody else and somebody else and somebody else. And it just got just tiring. Like, I had to, you know, it's ridiculous. And then even if that would have gotten figured out, it would have been at least like 10, 15 grand just to clear the songs. Like, figure like 250, 500 bucks a song. And for like a perpetual license for him to use on the movie and sell it. And this, you know, movie didn't have a budget to begin with, so it was like, okay, I can't do that. And so, you know, I uploaded the movie to YouTube privately for, like, reviewing purposes for, like, websites and all that. And then one day Universal Music, UMG, said they monetized the video, but they're going to still allow me to have it on YouTube. And I was like, oh, maybe I should just put it out there. And then a couple days ago, I did, and this huge relief to finally get it out there, and then so you know, whoever wanted to see it could get to see it and everything. So happy it's out there now.
So what are people saying about it? I mean, you can always like go, you post it on Facebook. You got your own Facebook page, the Bang Tango Movie. If people want to go check that out, and then you can go to YouTube. I mean, what are a lot of people saying about the movie?
Oh, it's been absolutely flattering. Like the response it's been getting, it's just all positive. I haven't had anybody say anything bad about it. Everybody's really really enjoys it. And I remember a couple months ago on Metal Sludge, on the message boards, because people were talking about it, like, yeah, when's this thing going to come out? And I was like, hey, you know, if you want to see it, I'll send you the private YouTube link to check it out. And there was like a 10-page thread on that forum about how everybody there really, really loved the movie. And I was like, holy crap, you know, this is, you know, Metal Sludge. They love hating it. They love picking apart everything and destroying everything. And that was like the most positive, like, thread, 10 pages of good reviews for it on there. And that was super flattering. And I was like, whoa, I'm just happy people like it. So it's been really cool.
It seems like, you know, everybody always says how rock fans always stick together. They're all like united and everything. But when you go to these websites, whether it be like Blabbermouth or Metal Sludge or whatever, everybody's always got something to say about every band, and it's not always positive. So I can imagine for you, you spent 4 years of your life making a movie about a band that really didn't make it big in the late 80s, early 90s, and people love it.
Right, it's so weird because I had that going against me to begin with. It's like Bang Tango for one, and for two, you're making a movie about him. What? And especially on Metal Sludge, you know, that this everybody loved it. Like, it's just all positive. And I was like, oh man, you know, it was pretty cool. But yeah, like on Blabbermouth, you know, a lot of those people, you see them talking about stuff, and it's just ridiculous how everybody's just so against each other just to be against each other about opinions and everything.
It's funny. It cracks me up because everybody wants rock and roll to survive, and we had Motley Crue retire, right? They just finished it up at a month ago, New Year's Eve or whatever, in Los Angeles. And I said, okay, Motley Crue's closing the door, one of those bands that were carrying a torch for so long. And then all of a sudden, Guns N' Roses say, hey, we're going to get back together, and everybody bitches about it not being the five original members. I mean, it is what it is, you know? I mean, you still got Axl and Slash in the band.
I agree, and that's going to do – I think that's going to do amazing things for rock music in general. You know, you got Axl, Slash, and Duff. And, you know, being able to – I'm sure they're going to sell out stadiums. You know, people are going to want to see that, and it's going to – make people interested again in that kind of music. And I think that's going to do great things for, like, you know, yeah, Bang Tango, Tough, you know, all those bands, LA Guns and everything, because people are going to want to hear that again. That's what I think.
Yeah, and then you have the Monsters of Rock cruises. You have, like, the M3 Festival, Rocklahoma. All this is all hard rock. But then again, you go on a website and there's a message board and everybody's just giving everybody shit about whatever.
Right, yeah, exactly. People get a little bit too opinionated for the sake of being opinionated nowadays.
It's just funny. It cracks me up because we've been doing the show for 4 years now, and it's like I always read all these messages and stuff about bands and everything, and I'm like, oh, God, everybody just, like, hates on every single thing. I mean, I get if you don't like something, but then they're ragging somebody for the way they look, and I'm like, oh, well, the guy's, like, over 50. I mean, what do you expect them to look like? I mean,
right,
I don't know.
Right, and it's like almost cool to like Bang Tango again, because a member for a long time while I was doing the movie, people were like, oh, what a joke, you know. But now people are starting to take them more seriously now again, and then that's really cool.
So did you, in the movie, did you follow those guys on tour a lot, or was,
yeah,
it, just, or was it just like periodically here, there, whatever? But I mean, it seemed like you were on tour with them a couple of times, and they were in the, there's a couple of scenes when they were in their bus, or they were in the recording studio.
Oh yeah, I was I was with them a lot. I really got to know those guys, and all the footage not in the movie, it's just hysterical. There's some great stuff. I was thinking about putting like deleted scenes and outtakes up on YouTube or something so people could check it out. And it was definitely an experience. It was, oh man, those guys are a lot of fun.
So we know how you made the movie, or how you came to start making the movie. So how did you wind up getting in Bang Tango as a guitar player?
Oh man. Well, throughout the whole like 4 years, I was like, hey, if you guys ever need a, you know, rhythm guitar player, just let me know. They're like, yeah, okay. Cause it's a two guitar player band. And then I screened the movie in Chicago, April of last year. And I did it so where, cause the band was on tour, I did it so where they would be in Chicago for it when it happened. And then we'd screen the movie. Everybody did it. It was great. And they had a show in Chicago a couple days after that at the Red Line Tap. And, you know, I was talking to Rowan, and he was like, dude, you should play some tunes with us, you know, that'd be cool. And so it was like what Joe called it on stage was the Make-A-Wish Foundation gig, because uh-huh. I always wanted to play with them. So I did that show with them. And then 2 days later, that Friday, I'm at work, and Joe calls me up in the morning. He's like, hey, Drew, quick question. How would you feel about playing in front of 20,000 people tomorrow at M3? And I was like, Joe, I'm renting the car right now.
Yeah.
And I drove 12 hours straight out to Maryland and did that with them, and that was an insane experience. And I guess Rowan really liked having a rhythm guitar underneath his playing, so he could be more free and creative with his lead playing. He's an amazing player, amazing guy too. Love Rowan so much. And
Robertson, right?
Yeah, Rowan Robertson from Dio, yeah. And DC4 and all that. It's just amazing stuff. And then they just kept on having me show up to the gigs, and then they're like, "Yep, you're in the band now." I'm like, "All right, cool." And it's just been like the most amazing bookend to this whole movie experience. It's like I did the movie on him, then now I'm in the band. It's like, whoa, you know, just, I'm still glowing from all that. And I decided not to put any of that in the movie. It's for one, I'm like the most least self-indulgent person in the world. I did, you know, this, it'd be weird. And I just, you know, I just had it end how it ended.
Yeah, I was going to say, you're not in the movie at all. I mean, you just obviously you filmed it and directed it and stuff, but you're not in the movie. At least I don't remember seeing you in the movie.
No, there's like a quick cut of me during the pistol whip stuff, like during one of the montages. But I figured, you know, this is their story, you know, and you know, didn't really want to put that at the end and to, you know, have that take away anything from them at all, you know, and all that.
Yeah, one more thing before I let you go. I mean, once again, people, you got to check out the Bang Tango movie, Attack of Life. Took him with Drew Fortier here, and the way you ended the movie was very interesting. I mean, tell me about how the movie ended. I mean, a little. I don't think I'm going to ruin it for people. It's not like it's a story that everybody is going to be surprised by the ending. But I thought it was very interesting the way you filmed the last couple of minutes of the movie.
Oh right, yeah, that was originally the movie ended differently. It ended abruptly. It was. When Joe says, oh, but that was then, who cares? Then it just ends. And then they wanted me to shoot a new ending, and they told me that this was in August of 2014, and they were playing this big gig at Pine Knob in Michigan, this big amphitheater, and they were playing with Dio Disciples, Queensryche, and Great White. And I was like, oh, perfect, that place is going to be packed, so, you know, that'll be the ending right there. So everybody, now here's Bang Tango playing in front of a huge crowd. And then they're about to go on. Doors open at like 7. They went on at like 7:15. So I'm there, and there's like nobody in the crowd. And I was like, well, this could work out pretty amazing as well for the ending. And so I shot that, and there you have it. That's the ending right there.
It was just really interesting because they're showing them in the dressing room, and there's a scene with Roland talking for a couple of minutes, and then there's a video of the band on stage, and then you kind of pan to the crowd, and it was just like, this is it. This is what it's become. And oh, yeah. It was just like, it was a perfect ending for the movie. It wasn't necessarily sad. It was just kind of like, hey, and that kind of wraps up the whole story.
Right. And their attitude was great about it because they knew that there was nobody there at the time, but they were still like, hey, let's go out and have some fun. And, whether it's, you know, 8 people or 8,000 people, it's still the same passion, and it's a beautiful thing.
Yeah, exactly. You got to play if there's 1,000 people or 5 people, just put on the same show. Okay, that great. I mean, I love the ending. But Drew, I want to thank you for being part of the Hard Rockology show.
You.
And tell people where they can check out the movie, or you got a website for it or anything?
Oh, well, you can just go on YouTube, just type in Attack of Life, the Bang Tango movie. You can check it out on Facebook and the Bang Tango movie on Facebook. Hope everybody enjoys it, and let's see where it goes.
And then what's plans for Bang Tango going forward the rest of 2016? What do you got going on with the band, since you're in the band now?
Well, there's some definitely intentions for recording. I know we want to do at least a couple of tunes and put something out there to show people that the band's still capable of being creative and putting out some good tunes, and all, especially with Rowan in the band. I know it's going to be some amazing stuff. And so that's definitely the plan for this year, to get something out there, something new, even if it's just a couple songs.
And you're playing a couple of big festivals, right?
Yeah. We're playing Rocklahoma in May with Megadeth and Disturbed and Scorpions. I'm super excited about that because I Collective Souls playing. I love all those bands.
All right, Drew, once again, I want to thank you for being part of the Hard Rockology show. So why don't you take us out of the interview by introducing one of your favorite Bang Tango songs.
Thank you so much for having me on the show, man. It's been a great time. Thank you. Let's hear Wrap My Wings. It's another one of my favorites by Bang Tango.
His wings, a clear glass cloud floats over my head. I float this space, don't mean a thing. I hear the echoes of my prayers. I fell down from floor 49. I hit the ground going 55. Silent night breaks my fall. My friend said, boy, you're dead.